as we've been talking about, it's so amazing to see the diversity here and the diversity amongst the speakers. And I want to introduce the superstar of this next family, the answer, Yancey McGregor. Yancey, come up. The answer. Yancey, how are you doing? Man, it's great to see you again.
Oh, it's so good to be
Yancey
here.
Yancey is such an amazing young lady. She is the wife of our next speaker. Yancey has an incredible background, former Miss Texas, former runner-up to Miss America. Yancey was on our worship team, one of our worship pastors. She and Chris went to Canada and started your great church, City Church. But talk a little bit, Yancey, because you're not from Canada. Listen to this accent. This is awesome.
Yes, and I thought that I was losing my accent.
Did you really?
I did, and I came home and told Chris, I said, I think I'm losing my Texas accent. People don't know. They say, where are you from? They don't immediately say you're from Texas. He said, that's not because you're losing your accent. That's because they've never heard a Texas accent before.
That's right.
They don't even know where you're from. They don't have any idea.
Yancey is so talented. We always used to say Yancey perspires charisma. She's got that much charisma. Yancey, tell us the names of like some of your family, because a lot of people won't believe like her.
I've got my family.
No,
I've got
way.
Two of my aunts right
this.
Here. My
Look
mom,
okay.
Susie.
Okay. Tell them. Yeah, just tell them. Go ahead.
You take okay. My my mom, Susie. My aunt, Celie. My aunt, Sherry. Uh-huh.
Stan.
Oh yeah.
Stan. Yes.
And then they have two brothers whose names are Smitty and Stran.
Listen, it's their brothers are named what?
Smitty and Stran.
Where are they?
They're not here.
Okay, they're not here.
They're route rodeoing, you know? That's what they do.
Yeah. That's her family, world-renowned rodeoers. I mean, I'm talking about the real deal. I mean, world champions. So go ahead. So some of the names. I love
the
names.
So Sherry has three kids, and their names are Shada and Cliff Dale and Tough Case Cooper. Yeah, and he can defend a name like Tough, too.
He can
defend it, yeah. And Seeley's boys' names are Vanden and Stetson and Sawyer.
You can't make this up.
You can't. You can't make
this
it up.
This is the real deal, guys. This is Texas.
I tried my best to come up with some names with Chris's family, and quite a few of them got vetoed.
Yeah,
along the way.
Because Yancey, Dallas is Texas, but it's not really Texas. You're from where?
I'm from the country. I'm
where?
From Childress, Texas. Anybody know where Childress is? Come on.
That's the deal.
The panhandle of, yeah.
Yeah, and there was like a giant billboard with your picture on it, home of Yancey.
Yes. I'm very famous in my town of 6,000
people. You are, Yancey.
People.
You really are. So Yancey.
Right, my family, yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, she is. Well, Yancey, are your kids here?
They are. They're out. They're in the preschool right now. Their
Excellent.
Old spot. They're over there today. They got reunited with all their old friends. They're loving
That's
it.
That's great. And their names are
Sterling and Kingston. See,
Kingston.
Those are good names.
That's a cool name.
They kind of
Sterling
fit with both. They're kind of a little bit Scottish, like my husband,
yes.
The McGregor, and a little bit country.
Now Yancey, tell me real quick, what's it been like moving from Dallas? Here, Chris was one of our pastors, one of our campus pastors here. You go and start a church in Canada. I mean, that's crazy.
Only God can ask you to do something
that's right.
like that,
Only
right?
Only God.
Uh-huh.
And you know what I love about it, too, is you guys went to Canada. Everybody and their brother wants to go to Atlanta, Dallas, somewhere where there's a bazillion, Los Angeles,
Sunny.
Tulsa.
Sunny.
Yeah. But you go to Canada, I love that.
Me too.
Well, what's been the most difficult thing?
Yeah, the snow. Thank you,
snow?
Rosanna. She said the snow. And you know, people talked about that before, and I was like, oh, that's so, yeah. Like, why are you gonna talk about the weather to me? But it's a factor. When you gotta dig your car out to take your boys to school in the morning, It's a difference for 4 months out of the year. But you know, the spiritual climate is very dark there. It's very different. And I think I've never been someplace where I felt like that people are just automatically against the spirit within me. Like, that's a tangible feeling. And you know how I like, I like people. Yeah, I'm
I know
a
woo, you do. Yes.
And that has hurt me, man. It's
hurt that's
me.
That's tough, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, the spiritual climate is so cold and so dark. Mm-hmm. And you know what I love too? And I believe this. See, Ott has one of the largest churches, Ott Basoff. Ott, right there. Let raise your hand, Ott. Ott, I love Ott. And Noretta, the brains behind the operation is Noretta, believe me. Look at Ott saying, yes, amen. But anyway, Ott has, you have who knows, 50,000 people showing up. What do you have, 40, 50, a lot. One of the biggest churches in the world. Okay. Ott's church is one of the best churches I've ever been a part of, I've ever seen, no doubt. Leadership culture. Ott is a soul winner. I love the Basoffs. Okay. But Chris's church and Yancey's church, how many of you guys run at you average? 179? Okay. Woo! It's easy. Yeah, okay. Ott. It's so easy, isn't it, to go, oh man, Ott and Noretta, and Stephen and Hollyford, whatever. David, at least he is. That's true. That's great. We learn tons. But also, we learn from churches that run 179. And who knows, in God's economy, and I will tell you this, maybe the city church is as effective or more so than Fellowship Church or whatever you want to say, Lake Hills. Life Point, Brad, you don't know, do you? And I would argue it probably is. So that's why I love the diversity, because I like to learn from churches that are just starting, you know, because you have that pioneer spirit. Oh, anyway.
And we're crazy. Who said that the other day?
You
right?
gotta be crazy. So, don't you guys love Yancey? She's so sweet. Their family's so great. Little Yancey. I mean, Yancey's so talented. I mean, I thought about it. She could just bust into some kind of incredible song right now, dance routine, and we'd be like, on your feet. You can, Yancey. Anyway, let's stand to our feet and put our hands together for Brother Chris McGregor. Chris McGregor, lead pastor. It's Montreal, not Toronto.
I love you, man.
Yeah, love you.
It's Montreal. Chris McGregor.
There. All right.
Yes.
How you guys doing today? As Ed said, Yancey and I were on staff here for about 10 years together, and just have 2 minutes to say one thing. This has made the trip worthwhile. Thank you.
Chris.
You're my spiritual father, and I've learned more about leadership, marriage, the family, and the topic I'm going to talk about in just a second. So I'm always preach for an audience of one, but I'm preaching for you today, and an homage to you and to Lisa. Thank you guys for your love, and we love you guys so much.
We love you and Yancey, and we know the best is yet to be.
Thank you.
No doubt. Thank you, man.
Thank you. You guys doing all right? I am so excited to be here today. And I just wanted to correct some misconceptions about Canada before we moved on, because I thought that would be appropriate, being a token Canadian. Now, Pastor Stephen, you've made a foray into Toronto, so thank you to that for investing in our country. And so you probably already know this. Canadian bacon is neither Canadian nor bacon. It's actually ham. So you can continue to order it if you want, but it's neither Canadian nor bacon. So just wanted to correct that misconception. The other thing I wanted to mention is that if you kind of see me in the hallway and you say, hey, do you know, that's awesome you're from Canada. Do you know Mike from Canada? You cannot imagine how many times I've heard someone say, do you know Mike from Canada? Awesome, you're from Canada. I'm like, it's possible. Where is Mike from? Oh, I don't know. It's somewhere up there, like Vancouver. Is that close to you? I'm like, yeah, it's about 3,000 miles apart. It's pretty close. So Canada's a big country. You can Google it sometime and just kind of look at the geography. So I was looking up how to give a great message, and one of the things was to alienate your audience in the first few minutes. So I've done that, accomplished that. So thank you. I want to put a picture up on the screen here and show you what my window looked like in February a couple years ago. Yancey and I were about to launch our church. We'd been there for about a year at that time. We'd been apprenticing at another church plant. And you can see the snow. The snow is a real factor. And as I looked out at that street, a couple of things went through my mind. First of all, it was desperation. We were calling everybody. We had contacted some churches. We had used Facebook and social media. We'd blown up every resource we possibly had to kind of get our launch team going. We wanted to get as many people as we could into our living room to start a Bible study so that we could launch this incredible movement of God called City Church. And we called it City Church because God gave us a vision at the C3 conference, not only for one city, but for the cities of the metropolitan cities of Canada. But here, this picture. I looked out at that bleak picture, and I thought to myself, God, how? How are we gonna get started? We had 11 people show up to our first amazing blown-up social media campaign. 11 people came to our house for our Bible study. That was January. In February, we had grown it to 9 people. It was phenomenal growth. March, 8 people. That's great leadership. I learned everything from Pastor Ed and Lisa. Yeah, kind of negative growth, a little negative. Yeah. So I was like, how, God, are we going to do this? I started to ask the question, what do we need to do to get people excited about the thing that we're excited about? How can we in some way impress upon them the passion that we have for the Lord Jesus Christ? I remember our first time in the mall doing what we always did, what Pastor Ed told us to do and taught us to do, is to go and hang out where you hang out and invite Jesus into that conversation. And so Yancey and I found ourselves at the Mac counter. And like every good husband, I was there to accompany her and support her. We had this amazing conversation for about an hour for a pretty attractive lady, but not as pretty as my wife, okay? So had this great conversation. It was going on and on. We were connecting, and this is our first weekend in Montreal, just kind of like, let's go check out the city a little bit. Talked to her about an hour, made this connection. She was upselling us. We were buying it because we wanted to tell her about Christ. And so we got to the courage to say, yeah, we're so excited. God's brought us all the way from Dallas to Montreal to start a church. And you would have thought that we had 4 eyes. She's like, what? What are you talking about? You know, start a church. And she said, what kind of church? And I said, a Christian church. You like a Catholic church or an Armenian church? Or I started going through the categories of something that would make sense to her. After 30 minutes, I failed miserably. There was no possible connection I could think of in that moment to help her understand what we were trying to accomplish. And she just walked away, and it hit me. We are in a world of trouble. The hows, the whats, the whos, the wheres were dominating my thoughts as I looked at that picture. And many of us have come to the C3 conference, this incredible conference that God has used over my life. This is my 13th C3 conference. And God has used this conference in ways that I can't even articulate. I was in that spot right over there when we sang the lyrics to a song that we sang hundreds of times at Fellowship Church. Take it out to the darkest spots. Shine the lights that's within our hearts. Light it up, light it up, light it up. God's got a sense of humor. Because when he talked about the darkest spots, he was talking about Montreal. We were praying and fasting. God had already told us to go to Canada. But like God often does, he doesn't give you specificity at the beginning. So we were praying between Toronto and Montreal. We're fasting and praying. Just God, give us clarity, give us direction. And would you know, in God's sense of humor, that he took us from the belt buckle of the Bible Belt, where there's a mega church, it seems like everywhere, to a city that Mark Twain once said is the only city he's ever been to that you couldn't throw a rock without hitting a stained glass window. And yet today, there are churches being converted into gay clubs, condos, spas. They're being sold all over the place because the churches are absolutely empty. It's a city in which there are less than 1%, 0.5% of the city is considered evangelical Christian. So as I looked at the street and I realized that I was embedded, and here's another thing about the sense of humor of God. Not only did we move from Dallas to Montreal, we moved into embedded in the middle of a Jewish neighborhood. I'm like, God, could you make it any more difficult for us? Like people are walking on the Sabbath to the synagogues. We're in a kosher grocery store. Like we don't know what's up. And then some of our neighbors are speaking Armenian and Ukrainian and French. And we're like, this is a phenomenal recipe for success, God, right here. Many of us have come to the C3 conference, though, with a lot of questions. The hows, the whats, the whos, the wheres. But I would argue that those are great questions. They're important questions. You're going to get them answered here. But the most important question are not those questions. If you answer this one question, all the other questions will make sense. It's the question of why. It's why. It's the why. When we were called by God in that chair right there, the first verse of scripture that God gave us is the last verse of the book of Jonah. Now, you might remember the story of Jonah, the whale, the reluctant prophet, but I want you to notice, and as you think about your own context, your own hamlet or community or city or metropolitan, maybe you're even reaching Europe, like my friend Ott up here. But as you think about your context, listen to what's God's heart. Listen to the why of God in Jonah chapter 4, verse 11. Should I not have concern? Should I not have concern for the great city of Nineveh, in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their left from their right, and also many animals? Now, I don't know about you, but Montreal is very, very similar to Nineveh. And the rest of the story is that Nineveh repented, this dark city that practiced animals and human sacrifices, human and baby sacrifices, a horrible, evil city. God had compassion because they were so lost and they were so confused that they needed a messenger from God to give them the why. And God sent me all the way from this dark city of Montreal to remind me, I need this more than anybody, and to remind you that the why is the most important question for us to answer. Here's a couple of things about the why that's important. The why is clarifying. When you answer the why question, the what, the how, the where, the who's, and all that other stuff falls right into place. The why is also inspiring, isn't it? When you remember the why of God, when you connect your why to the heart of God, you get fired up. That's important. Because if the flicker of hope and faith dies out in you, then what hope do our city has? What hope does our church have? But, however, it is inspiring to other leaders. When we keep our eye on the why, it's like bees to honey. Because the heart of God connects people, and God says to send workers for the harvest. He's always got people ready to join you in the answer of the why. But the final thing about the why that's important to remember, we're going to see this in this next story, is that the why is absolutely polarizing. It is polarizing. Not everyone digs the why question. As I found myself looking at that street, all the other questions that I wanted to answer was because the why question was too hard, too messy, too difficult. Let's look at the why of Jesus for a few moments, can we? Luke chapter 19. Now, this is intimidating because I'm in front of all these pastors and leaders and theologians and doctors and PhDs, but I think we can learn something today from the Word of God because the Holy Spirit is living and active. He's going to drop something into our spirit today. Let's look at the why of Jesus. Luke chapter 19, verses 5 through 10. Very familiar story. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to them, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house." So that was a Canadian pronunciation, house. Your house today. So he came down at once and he welcomed him gladly. And all the people saw this and began to what? Began to what? Mutter, not muzzard, mutter. He's gone to the guest of a sinner. But, I love that but. But Zacchaeus stood up and he said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. If I have cheated anybody out of anything, I'll pay them back four times the amount. Now, just as a side note, if you're gonna reach somebody, you might as well reach rich people. I mean, if God's gonna call you to the why and reaching people, it might as well be the rich extorters, the scumbags of the world that's got all this wealth, right? Because maybe they'll give back some money in the offering plate. I've heard that some pastors and some churches need some financing. Well, lost my notes. A little pastor humor there. Hashtag preacher humor. Verse 9 and 10. We're having fun here. Jesus said to them, "Today, listen to this, salvation has come to his house because this man too is a son of Abraham." Here's the key verse. The key verse of Dr. Luke's gospel, and I would argue the why of Jesus Christ. This is the mission statement, the vision. This is what was tattooed on Jesus' arm. "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." Now in this story, three groups of people. Pharisees. These were the insiders, right? These were the knowledgeable ones. And I started to dog the Pharisees in my mind as I was studying this text, but then I thought to myself, these guys tithed. These guys knew their Bible. They always showed up on time. These would make some great volunteers. Maybe not small group leaders, but maybe some good ushers or something like that. But these guys were the insiders. They were defenders, weren't they? Defenders of the tradition, defenders of the Torah, defenders of Israel. And then you have Zacchaeus, a scumbag, a dirtbag. Can I say that in church? I just did. An extorter of widows and orphans, using his position to take away the wealth of Israel. Now, Israel and the Jewish people hated tax collectors, because they were aligned with the Roman Empire and they despised being in captivity. And the Pharisees' job, the Pharisees' why, was to get them out of captivity. And they thought if they could just keep their noses clean, if they could just keep in the boundaries of what the Torah said, if they could just do what God had always said for them to do, that God would somehow redeem them and rescue them. Only one problem. The Pharisees took their eye off of the why of God. So Zacchaeus is this lost, dark, despised human being. And so he climbs the tree to get a picture and a view and a glimpse of this Jesus he's heard so much about. And I have to wonder in this instance, what was it that really motivated Zacchaeus to have a think that he had a shot of getting rescued, of getting somehow forgiven by this amazing person called Jesus Christ? And I think part of it is because he saw the entourage of Jesus and he said, "Hey, I used to know that guy, Levi. He was a tax collector too." Maybe, just maybe, maybe he thought that he had a chance of not being an outsider anymore, of not being despised and rejected, because Jesus had already picked up one of his group, another tax collector. And then you have Jesus. And as I was studying and researching, I was immediately on my page, I wrote down, well, Jesus is an outsider too. He's an outsider just like Zacchaeus was, wasn't he? But then I thought about it, Pastor Darius, and I thought about it some more. And I thought about it some more. And I thought to myself, Jesus was not an outsider, and Jesus was not an insider. He was an insider outsider. Now, here's interesting about this text, about this collision that Jesus has with this lost scumbag. This is the last recorded salvation in Dr. Luke's gospel. Jesus had one foot in Jericho, the last time he would ever come through Jericho. The last time he would ever be in the north, he was heading, the scriptures say, like flint towards Jerusalem. He had one foot in Jericho, one foot towards this scumbag named Zacchaeus, but he had one foot pointed towards the cross. And I have to wonder, in that whole exchange with Zacchaeus, is it possible that Zacchaeus gave him a little memento, a little coin that Jesus put in his pocket and he left with as he went directly to the cross? I have to wonder, when Jesus was being whipped and tortured and beaten for the outsiders of the world, I have to wonder if it wasn't the face, the desperation of this scumbag Zacchaeus that motivated him to stay on that cross, to die the death that you and I deserve to die, because he lived the life that we couldn't live. And I think that is why Jesus, when later on in the story, when the disciples are taking selfies of themselves on the way to Jerusalem, wow, Jesus, look at that building, look at that building, look at that building. You know what Jesus does? He weeps over the city of Jerusalem. He weeps over the lost because he knows that there are thousands, hundreds of thousands of people that are without a savior, that are lost, that are outsiders. And so in the story, we see a contrast, don't we? A contrast to what happens when there is a burning building, a different approach for when people are lost. How do we approach the lost? How do we approach the broken, the confused? Like Jonah said, that don't know their left from their right. How do we approach them? The Pharisees were the defenders of the gospel. Don't get me started on that. Gospel protectors. These were the traffic cops setting up a barricade so that nobody would get hurt. It's their fault that they were smoking in bed. It's their fault that they overloaded the circuits. Instead, what does Jesus do when he sees a burning building? He straps on the firefighter gear, the oxygen tank. He runs into a burning building. Keep your eye on the why. Keep your eye on the lost. Keep your eye on the broken, the confused, the hurt. Or else. Your passion, your vision, and yes, ultimately your church will wither and die. If your why is not the why of God, that you have no promise that your vision is going to flourish, that your church is going to flourish, that you are going to do what God has said you're supposed to do. If you take your why off the heart of God and the mission of Jesus, then you are by yourself. You're by yourself. So here's the question. Why do we not want to answer the why question, as I alluded to earlier? The why is hard, isn't it? Isn't it hard to keep knocking on the doors when you get rejected? Isn't it hard to continue to go to the mall knowing that likely they're not going to want anything to do with you, that your relationships that you're starting to build with this other mom in the playgroup is going so well, then all of a sudden they find out that you're a pastor's wife, and boom, it's closed. Or like us, we made the decision prayerfully to send our kids to the public school. In December this last year, they did a curriculum, 3 weeks of the holiday season, 1 week celebrating Hanukkah, the other week celebrating Kwanzaa, the third week celebrating Christianity by celebrating Santa Claus. The curriculum was about Santa Claus, nothing to do with Jesus. The only name that's scandalous in your city, in my city, increasingly so here in the United States, I come from a post-Christian, post-modern city. It's not far behind, guys. I hate to tell you that. Keep your eye on the why. Keep your eye on the why, or else your vision, your passion, even your church will wither and die. And so we stop. We can't answer this question because it's hard. It's so slow. It is so slow. We've been befriending these people for 3 years now since we moved in. Their son is my son's age, and their other son is my son's age. They go to the same school, man and wife, husband and wife. We've done this with them and that with them. We've done everything with them, had them over for dinner, Super Bowl parties, this and that, all the time. My son Sterling accepted Christ the second month that we arrived in Montreal, in my basement. and he is an evangelist. He is filled with the Spirit of God. And so that's when we send him every day. I walk them to school. You know what I'm doing? I'm praying over them. Holy Spirit of God, greater is he that is in them than he that is in the world. And one day at lunchtime, my son Sterling was talking to his friend about this Jesus that he absolutely loves, that has wrecked his world, that has captured his thoughts. He might have gone a little bit far. He started talking about the lake of fire, but that's another story. But he told him about the Lamb of God, the sacrifice, and how Jesus paid the penalty for our sin, that if we want to be a friend of God, if we want to be have eternity with God in heaven, all we need to do is believe that Jesus is the Christ, and he died for you, and he wants to give you a second chance. When I heard that, I was like giving him a high five. I was taking him out for ice cream. Like, I was blessing the socks off my son. He gets it so much more than I ever did. But do you know what his mom, the other kid's mom, said to my wife? Hey, you might want to tone it down a little bit. I mean, I know that it's probably made your husband really proud, but I don't think other kids would appreciate that. It's hard. It is slow. Oh my goodness, is it ever messy? It is messy to be around the lost. We had a Super Bowl party a couple weeks ago for the express purpose of getting around lost people. I know that's crazy. We might have even had a couple of adult beverages there. I'm just saying. Hashtag. Gotta keep it real. It's messy, though, because you try to make them comfortable in your home, and that's going to require you doing things that you thought maybe you wouldn't do or shouldn't do, and you have to use the Holy Spirit of God as your compass point, and you have to do what God tells you to do, and if that includes doing things that you thought you'd never do, then you do it because there's a greater why behind the what and the how and the whens and the messiness of all that relationship. So as leaders, what do we do? We take our eye off the why. We start answering the easier questions. The easier questions. Instead of focusing on the lost that are hard and messy and slow, we say, well, let's change the espresso beans. Because that's measurable, right? That's instant. Let's change the color of the nursery walls. Let's change the signage. Let's change the worship leader. Let's change the student pastor. Let's change my fashion. But can I just tell you, those are great things, and maybe that's what you need to do if God's telling you to do that. But if you take your eyes off the why, you're not aligned yourself with God. If we take our eyes off the why, three things happen. We go from the Father's heart, the heart of a compassionate, gracious God, to this false illusion of progress. We do what many husbands do, right? Many fathers do. Spend a couple hours later at the office because at least there it's measurable. At least my work is measured. At least I get a pat on the back. Because at home, my kid may throw up on the ground, or I might have to get down on my knees and wreck my suit, or whatever the case might be. And so we would rather have determined progress than false progress. We take our eyes off the Father's heart. Here's a big one. Pastor David said this so eloquently. Jesus asked us to be fishers of men. We take our eyes off the why. We go from being a fisher on the front lines to being a manager. We go from being in the deep waters of the rescue, and instead, we just try to tweak this and tweak that and tweak this because we want that false illusion of success because it makes us feel better. It numbs us to the why. And finally, we go from the front lines to the sidelines. We take the bleeding edge of Jesus, who had one foot in Jericho and one foot towards the cross, and instead, we hang out in our office, we get our commentaries out, we go on Facebook and we read about this gospel conference and this gospel book and that gospel book, and we take away the why. We step away from the front lines where the lost are broken and confused and hurt, not knowing their left from their right, and instead, we settle for being managers of something that already is. So I want to close with one story and one picture. Last Wednesday, I got an email from a lady in our church, and you know, you get emails all the time, and sometimes they're good, sometimes they're not. This one was a little troubling. She said, we actually just been gone through a whole series on prayer called The Circle Maker. Maybe you've heard of it. Thank you for your gift. I thought about being creative and calling it the Rhombus Maker or the Rhombus, you know, something different, but I you know, just saying. I just used it, ripped off the logo, ripped it all off. It was awesome. And she was praying. We were fasting together as a church, and she emailed me and said, you know, when I'm praying, I'm hearing these voices, and they're bothering me. I said, okay, well, what? Tell me about these voices. And so she said, I feel like when I'm praying and trying to concentrate on God that I'm getting these really condemning words, these false accusations. I'm going to baptize this language here, but no, I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to keep it real. The voice was calling her a whore and a slut. Because I just got to tell you how it is. That was the voice that she heard when she was trying to pray. And this is a woman that was a single parent. She had been not promiscuous at all. She hadn't had relationships with a man for a long time. And I started to realize that this was a demonic voice. Because the Father, his heart is compassion and love and grace and truth, loving his kids. And if you hear the voice, the false lies of accusation and condemnation, that is a tipping point to help you realize that there is an evil presence. And so I invited her over to our house with Yancey around the kitchen table, and for a couple hours, there was a spiritual battle royale going on in my kitchen. Asking her the simple question, like you would do. Well, tell me about when you accepted Christ. Tell me about that time when you transferred your trust from yourself to Jesus Christ, who paid the price for your sins and rose again. Tell me about that. And she said, what do you mean? Now, this is a lady who had been attending other churches for a couple of years. She actually sang on the stage of our church, City Church. And of all the people that attended my church, I would say that she was probably in the upper thirds of people that got it. But she was lost and confused and condemned by Satan himself. And in that spiritual battle going back and forth, she dismissed herself for a little while, went into another room. She turned the lights off, and I said, just go and pray and see what God says for you to do. She came back, and she was shaken, and she said, I felt like God was telling me that I hadn't given my heart to him, that I've given parts of me, and I've had these spiritual experiences that I felt kind of close to God, but I've never given my life to Jesus. And do you know, for 35 to 45 minutes, we were just going after her, because she was lost, and she was confused, and she was broken. And as far as it depended on me, I was not going to let her leave our house, condemned by Satan himself. She finally prayed the sinner's prayer. Awesome. And the coolest thing about that, I said, what happened? What happened? Because I knew that there's some spiritual stuff going on. It said, as soon as I prayed that, I saw me in a white robe. You can't make this up. I was in a white robe, and I saw light all around me, and for the first time, that voice went away. My friends, we are not ashamed of the power of the gospel. God can change anything. There's a picture I want to show as we close. It's a picture that hangs over it's a cross that hangs over the city of Montreal. In 1643, almost 400 years ago, a priest was concerned because there was a flood on the St. Lawrence River that was going to overwhelm the city of Montreal, this little settlement village. And he made a vow to God, God, if you will spare the city, he initiated a prayer and fasting through this whole settlement. He said, God, if you'll spare the city, I'll take this cross from the banks of the St. Lawrence River and I'll drag it to the very top of the mountain to serve as a reminder that you saved and spared the city. A couple weeks later, the floodwaters subsided. The priest made good on his vow. And today, when we are in those dark moments where I'm wanting to wrestle with the what's and the how's and the who's and the where's, I see this symbol and it reminds me that my Jesus, my God, is a God of the why. He is a God who's concerned. He loves the city of Montreal. He loves the lost. And there is nothing too difficult for God. Keep your eye on the why. Let's do this, church. In Jesus' name.